Hello friends, I am Ordhendu De and you are watching ADC English Literature. Today, we are reading Egdon Heath, the famous fictional location, particularly as it has been described in the first chapter of Thomas Hardy's beautiful novel, The Return of the Native. Like the location of Malgudi of Narayana, the world of Egdon Heath in Thomas Hardy's novel, The Return of the Native, is the most sought after articulation in English literature. If you want to get a glimpse of Hardy's style of writing as well as the great theme of Immanent Will, just read a few lines from Book 1, Chapter 1, A Face on Which Time Makes But Little Impression. You will be thrilled by its poetic beauty, the descriptive qualities, and the thrilling nocturnal associations. But before we begin, a few words on Thomas Hardy. Thomas Hardy, the Grand Victorian, the novelist and poet, was born in 1840. Despite his initial love of poetry, Thomas Hardy turned to be the novelist as his primary literary form in order to make a living during his time. Often his contemporaries would treat him as the first English counterpart of European great novelists like that of Flaubert, Tolstoy, and Zola. But Hardy's was an older art of storytelling. Critical of contemporary theories of realism, he sought his model in the primal oral tale. As he said, "We storytellers are all ancient mariners." And so, behind his novels, we feel the formative presence of ballads of love, passion, and love that is running after centuries. The provincial and countryman, Hardy remained a primitive despite his wide knowledge of the literature, science, and philosophy of his day. And it was here that he differed from his contemporaries like George Eliot and Henry James. It was because of his provincialism and naivete that his strength lay. In a way, Hardy can be compared to Scott. He deliberately revived the name of Wessex in his novels as it seemed to have historical weight. Being native to Heathland, where nothing could be grown because of the sand in the soil, since farming on Egdon was not possible, the people there lived by gathering turf, forage, and making brooms. As a boy, most probably Hardy has seen all this. His long walks to the school helped Hardy to know the country and the people. Though he loved to look at things from a distance, but even though sight proved to be a vital creative eye. His father, a master mason, introduced his son to the business world of his and to nature. And his mother made him aware of the history and the legends that opened up new vistas and newer avenues of interests Hardy loved to explore. And his novels, particularly The Return of the Native, is plenty to prove his great artistry of observation, eyesights, and insights. In Return of the Native, the features of Greek tragedy, that is fate, nemesis, hubris, hamartia, all incorporated. Though it was difficult for a novelist to impose a tragic structure on a novel, but Hardy has succeeded in doing so. It seems tragedy was Hardy's natural inclination. And he believed that the novel should be an expression, an impression of life, however tragic the relationships in this life might be. Again, there were many texts of Thomas Hardy based on animism. You know animism, the belief that all objects have a spiritual being. This belief led to his careful stewardship of nature out of fear or respect for these divine spirits. Moreover, there is rustic lifestyle, dependent on nature, become respectful attire in his writing. The same is true for his Return of the Native. Here, nature is presented through the Egdon Heath, the very location. It is the fictitious location area that most probably Thomas Hardy's Wessex. Hardy draws Egdon Heath keeping in mind Dorchester and northwest of Wareham broadly. But before we go to describe Egdon Heath, it might be appropriate to understand the very storyline of the Return of the Native. The story of the Return of the Native is a tragic love story like his other novels. The plot of it is very simple. Clemy of Wright, a diamond merchant in Paris, returns home to serve his countrymen as a teacher and preacher. He falls in love with and marries Eustacia High, who has a secret love affair with Wildeb. Eustacia resumes her affair with Wildeb, who has a wife, Thomasine. When Eustacia and Wildeb die, Thomasine marries Gregory Van, the traveling riddleman who, like the guardian angel, is found brooding over the action of the novel from the very beginning. Clyne, the hero, remained lonely and isolated as a lone tragic figure at the end of the novel. The true subject of the novel of the Return of the Native is the very background, Egdon Heath itself. Even a single novel may be taken as the key to Hardy's mind and art. It is the Return of the Native, and the primary focus is on Egdon Heath, the very location. Book first, the Three Women, chapter 1 of the novel opens with a description of the setting, Egdon Heath, a face on which time makes but little impression, which is a dark, sinister and morbid. The words and phrases Hardy uses here to describe it are often long and clumsy. The prose style is awkward and stilted, but remember that it is intentional and it is very much fits in with the somber mood of the novel, that is the tragedy. The novel begins in the month of November, in which even the colors are somber and the mood is frightening. The characters of Hardy fit the mood of the setting, and we are made aware that the story is likely to be a somber tragic in five acts. The Heath describes the real circumstances in which man lives. What the individual feels about the circumstances is irrelevant, but he cannot really escape them. He is caught in the heat, which is an extended labyrinth. A Saturday afternoon in November was approaching the time of twilight, and the very tract of an enclosed wild known as Egdon Heath embrowned itself moment by moment. Overhead, the hollow stretch of whitest clouds shutting out the sky as a tent which had the whole heath for its floor. It was a sunny Saturday afternoon in November. Dusk was approaching. the great stretch of unfenced wilderness known as the Egdon Heath grew dark moment by moment. Though the sky was still bright, the woodcutter, looking up, would have felt that there was still time before night. And would have wanted to continue his work. But if he had looked down into the hill, he would have felt that the night had almost fallen and he would have decided to go home. No one could understand Heath if they hadn't been present at that time. Indeed, the Heath was very similar to the night. So, the very first two and three paragraphs describes this nocturnal setting. The place become full of a watchful intention now. For when other things sank brooding in sleep, the Heath appeared slowly to awake and listen. At this hour, Egdon Heath became a place full of a watchful intention, because when other things fell into a sleep of, the Heath appeared slowly to awake and listen. Just remember the words, just try to comprehend the words. Everything is in silent sleep, only but Heath is awake. Every night its huge form seemed to wait for something, but it had waited thus unmoved for centuries, and one could think that it now waited for one last crisis, the final overthrow. So, what is this final overthrow? That is the colossal force with which Heath is possessed with, and it has the mighty power, if he desires, to overthrow anything of its displeasure. Intensity was more usually reached by way of Solomon than by a brilliant, and such a sort of intensity was often arrived at during winter darkness, tempests and mists. Then Egdon was aroused to reciprocity. Twilight combined with the beauty of Egdon Heath created a scene that was majestic and impressive, but not severe and sweet. It was emphatic in its warning and grand in its simplicity. The ascetic would have felt that he had the natural right to wander, to put himself in the influence. But on summer days, did Egdon Heath's mood touch the level of cheerfulness? His intensity was of earnestness rather than gentle health and vitality. That kind of intensity is often reached during winter darkness, storm and mist. The storm was Egdon's lover and the wind was his friend. At such times, the Heath became the home of strange phantoms. So, Heath's popularity is not only dark, not only its vastness, but also its phantom desires. It was at present a place perfectly accordant with man's nature, neither ghastly, hateful, nor ugly. Again, it says it had a lonely face, suggesting tragical possibilities. The Heath at that hour was a place perfectly in keeping with man's nature, neither scoopy, hateful, nor ugly, neither commonplace, meaningless, nor tame, but like man, offended and persistent, and at the same time singularly colossal and mysterious in its dark monotony. Solitude seemed to look down on us with a frown. There was an expression on its face that suggested that it had experienced a lot of sadness in its life. So, Egdon is like that of a tragical possibilities that had the ancient reputation of doing tragedies who is not getting Egdon Heath in its true spirit. Again it says, the great inviolate place had an ancient permanence which the sea cannot claim. Egdon Heath was always difficult to manage and had always been so. Civilization was its enemy and the land always were the same. This great inviolate place having an ancient permanence that looked both ancient and eternal. The sea changed, the fields changed, the rivers, the village, the people changed, but Egdon remained. A dilapidated highway passed through the lower floors of Heath, on which a more dilapidated wheelbarrow, rainbarrow is there. And the descriptive lines, it says, the sea changed, the fields changed, the rivers, the villages, and the people changed, yet Egdon remained. The description of Egdon Heath in the opening chapter is famous. Famous for its poetic worth, famous for its descriptive words, famous for its tragic possibilities. Not only does Hardy make Egdon Heath come alive by his vividness of description, but he creates a solemn and somber atmosphere which seems fitting prelude to the story. And the story is a tragic one. This description also shows Hardy's sensibility to nature, its various aspects and its various moods. So reading Egdon Heath most probably lead us into the theme of straight away. We cannot miss one thing, that this book one, or the interior of the Return of the Native, the whole of the characters, rustics, all the major characters are somehow involved with the Egdon Heath. Whoever don't get Egdon Heath in its true spirit, whoever cannot get the meaning of the Egdon Heath or its colossal power, is wasted. And those who accept it makes a good deal in this situation and have a prosperous life. So the three women and their respective approaches towards Egdon Heath is very vital in understanding Egdon Heath. I also like to make a few points regarding this. Coming to the characters involved, Egdon Heath has different implementations on them. Ustasia Bhai, Thomasin and Mrs. Seabright, the three major characters that we find in book one of the Return of the Native, all these three characters, the major women characters, had their different reactions and outlook towards Egdon. And that outlook makes their possible encounters. Ustasia hates Egdon and calls her head her cross, and in the course of the novel it proves to be her death. Egdon makes Ustasia further melancholic and bored, and bore her to the extremity that sometimes she even fails to commit suicide. She becomes gloomy, self-centered, rebellious and bitter. As it is a place devoid of pleasure, Ustasia finds herself here, a kind of entrapment. In Egdon, Ustasia finds it as if a hungry person of pleasure. Her desires for amusement is so scary in Egdon. Comparatively, she is finding solace in the thought of escapism to the pompous world of Paris, rejecting these gloomy surroundings. Her constant fight against the Egdon and her constant fight against the very situation there, her own situation also, and its surrounding locations of Egdon, the gloomy atmosphere. She tragically at last meets a tragic suicide death by the side of the pool. But Thomasin Ebride, however, is quite at home in Egdon. She would rather be unhappy elsewhere. It is familiar old place, but she cannot appreciate the gaiety of it on equal terms. There is no ghost in Egdon for pretty Thamsi. Egdon also accepts her and makes her happy at the end of the play when Thomasin is getting united with Riddleman. Mrs. Eubright is quite contenting in her Egdon situation. Though a curate's daughter, she finds herself quite nothing abnormal, in fact, staying here. But she has a sense of superiority over the country folk. There is no further explanation regarding her reaction towards Egdon. It must be accepted that she is a character saturated with the obnoxious varieties of Egdon. Now, the chorus party in The Return of the Native is quite accepting the Egdon situation. They are in fact the emblem of Egdon situations. In fact, all of the chorus party or all of the rustic characters that we find in The Return of the Native are much saturated in the situations of Egdon gloomy atmosphere, and they accept the reality and they find peace and solace in that situation or in their situations. Now, one character that I cannot miss is Climb Eubright, the hero. The hero is quite not getting Egdon in its true spirit. Climb even is living in this Egdon, not with the propulsion of love for Egdon, rather a compulsion and an idealistic compulsion. That idealistic compulsion is nothing to do in accepting Egdon or not. So his situation is quite challenging one, and Egdon finally rejects him too. But spiritually, and at the very end, when we find that Climb Eubright has get a final lesson of living a life, so that particular lesson or philosophical lesson has provided by Egdon Heath, and that is nothing is small accomplishment or small achievement by Climb Eubright. So Egdon Heath and its vivid situations, in its nocturnal nature, in its colossal force of nature, we can find out shapes and modules, the different characters and different personages, and even the different time frames and situations, favorable as well as not so favorable or tragic, is made possible by this Egdon Heath. So this entire discussion will be fruitful to you, with that hope that you can better understand this Egdon Heath and get set yourself ready for reading this novel, because you can have a proportion of study of Hardy in reality, in truest term, if we begin just with a few chapters of The Return of the Native, that you can get a full or at least a better glimpse of Hardy's style of writing, as well as his topic of stating the nature in comparison to man's or human's behavior. So it is better way to make a new beginning, I say, start reading this book chapter 1 and try to understand Egdon Heath in its true spirit. It will lead you further studies. Like, share, comment, and obviously subscribe to my channel to get this kind of lectures and further. Bye bye. Thank you.